Okay, so let's begin with the lightning talk session on day four. So I would briefly like to explain how this works for the audience and the speakers. First of all, for the speakers, please sit in one of the front rows so you can get up on stage quickly and deliver your talk. Delivering your talk is pretty easy. You just have to talk into the microphone. Please don't turn around because we can't pick you up then because, yeah, you see what I mean. You can see the slides down on this monitor here. You don't need to check out the slides on the big screen. Stay calm, talk loud and clearly. Finish on time, get your applause and leave the stage. Thank you. I'm not going to leave yet. I say the same things in every session. Never mind. For the audience, how to listen to lightning talks, please be excellent to each other and watch the timekeeper because we would like to make sure that every speaker is in time. So how do you read the timekeeper? How do you process the information that's displayed by this column here or the column on the big screen? Alex, would you like to explain that? We need some audio for the podium table.
Good morning.
Hello. Hello.
Yeah, you have to talk a bit louder, I think.
We have no audio here. Maybe you... hello. Good morning, everybody. Most of you should know by now how the timekeeper works. As long as the timekeeper shows a green light, if you see the green rising column like this, you're in the first 4 minutes of your talk, so you have plenty of time. If it starts to turn yellow at the bottom like this, these are you're nearing the end of the talk. You still have, at this moment, about 30 seconds left, and the last 30 seconds will be shown in red. And due to our new policy to be more speaker-friendly, we don't use the buzzer anymore. So if the speaker nears the end of its talk, you go, please, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
All right, I think that works. At least it works for me. So we initiated the countdown, we practiced that. There are translations available, so all the English talks are going to be translated into German, the German talks are going to be translated into English. And to see the details, how to listen to these translated streams, check out c3lingo.org. And please give a big hand for the translation team again. Okay, that's it. Let's start with the first speaker.
Okay, so thank you very much for this nice introduction. My name is Carsten and I want to talk about a web application which I'm currently developing, and its aim is to facilitate the more constructive and less frustrating digital discussions. And the motivation for this is that there's an increasing world population and technological development, and the world is getting more complex, and this results in an increasing necessity for communication and coordination, and this is often very cumbersome. And then we have misunderstandings, emotionalization, reinforcing feedback, and often communication breaks down. And from my point of view, this is a big threat for the whole civilization. There are examples on many scales. For example, on a global scale, we have climate politics, where we have like two camps which cannot even talk to each other. On a national scale, the German one of you might probably know this, there's a very emotional debate on how to use, or whether to use at all, gender-sensible language. I wrote down an example here. And even on a local scale, there's example of how communication can fail, which I want to detail it this slide. At my local hackspace, there's a mailing list, and about a year ago, they break up a discussion of when to start the regular meeting. And at the second email, there was a proposal to start at 7:30 p.m. And 15 emails later, the same person stated that I don't understand the whole discussion. I'm really annoyed. Soon I will quit, and then you can all organize it by yourself again. So this is an example of a quite simple topic, which led to complete breakdown of, or almost complete breakdown of communication. So even in small homogeneous groups, there's the risk of escalation. And my solution proposal is that we should use better tools. And this is motivated by the difference between a usual forum and this platform Stack Overflow, which you probably know. I think this drastically improved the communication, at least for this one use case, programming questions. And I know there are other very similar platforms for other topics, but I think we need something for usual or for regular discussions. And the key points which made this successful is that the content is not ordered by chronology, but by quality. And we have avoidance of redundancy and a better focus on the topic. And as I already said, we need similar features for normal discussions. There are already examples for this. Like, I don't know whether you know this, this is Brabble, and there are other pages, and they use formalization to display contra versus pro arguments, and they have ratings for the quality of the arguments, but there are drawbacks because this is somehow superficial. You cannot go into the depth, and it's not free and open source software. So I thought, let's do it by myself, and I wrote a web application which is available at eurosober-arguments.net, and it has some features which I think are suitable for this whole process. So first of all, there's a strong formalization of discussions. You have some which I call bricks, so elements of discussions or atoms of discussions. And yeah, these types of bricks are thesis, pro-argument, contra-argument, question and improvement suggestion, and they are somehow highlighted by these different colors. And then you can go into the depth. This means you can add a contra-argument to another argument and so have some kind of argument trees. And there's an explicit field for references, so every author of an argument should have the urge to add some references. And it's open source software. The main drawback is that's in early alpha stage and that I'm not a really good web developer and even worse designer, so you can see it's kind of ugly, but the aim is just to develop a proof of concept. So why could this be useful? It could help small groups in opinion forming, and it could help individuals to get an overview of discussions. And if you're interested, you can visit the either the GitHub page or the URL of the project. Thank you.
So good morning. Good morning, everybody. Refreshing memories. So let me ask you a question this morning. Who remembers the Homebrew Computer Club? A few hands going up. The Homebrew Computer Club officially started in 1975, and people didn't know much about computer at that time, meet together, exchange knowledge, did projects together, hardware and software projects, and really tried to bring the technology into the hands of the people. And if you dig deeper, you find that behind that is a movement that was started by Stuart Brand, because he already wrote an article 3 years earlier in 1972 about the hackers community. And Stuart Brand, to give you the link, is the founder of the Whole Earth Catalog and the Long Now Foundation. And his community is still active in these days. And one of the guys started DIY robocars to bring technology of autonomous driving into the hands of the people. So in a way, we have a similar situation compared to the PC area in 1975 to autonomous driving in 2018. And what you see here is one of the guys going very fast with an OpenCV based technology. They recognize the tracks, and what they do is they autonomously drive and try to beat the best human. So if you're located in the Bay Area, that's the way to go. You find all the details there, all the procedures to build up your own car. So there are other groups, like our friends in Ann Arbor and in Detroit, and they only they even go further, and they set up an application of a robot that can drive autonomously in a greenhouse and detect plant diseases of tomato plants. So if you're located in Ann Arbor or Detroit, that's the way to go. How did I myself became interested in self-driving cars? I was so lucky to be part of the first team to finish the self-driving car engineer at Udacity. And what you see here is one of our first try that we ever made the car move. That was quite difficult, and you see it's still very buggy. And that was a really fun project with a great team working together at the final project, and that made me started a meetup we have in Stuttgart now, Connected Autonomous Driving, and you see two projects we already built. One is in the car, a live detection of other cars and pedestrians, and some very, very small examples of getting a small robot that you can build within an hour driving around a track. So the hurdle is not that high. You can very easily start yourself. We're currently in the process of setting up a track and building up our own cars. So that's in the Schreck space in Stuttgart. It's the car of Alexander Kolbei, who's very active in the community as well. And the opportunity for you all who are interested in this kind of technology is quite amazing, because you can learn about computer vision, you can learn about behavioral cloning together with training neural nets, you can learn about path planning. Some of you may have seen the talk about the Mars rover. So a lot of what has been discussed there about path planning, you can directly learn here in these kind of projects. And then you can learn about sensor fusion as well. So if you're interested, come and join us at Connected Autonomous Mobility. We are here at the assembly together with our friends from the Automotive Security Research Group. And there's one thing I would like to add. We just only talked about single cars and single robots, and the title is about connected. So imagine in the PC area, 1975, we only had the PC and only a few networks. Imagine what is possible if we link all those robots together in a manner that is really helpful for people. So if you're interested, come and join us, and have fun. Thank you very much.
Hi, thanks so much for the opportunity. So I'll briefly talk about smart contract security, in particular Ethereum smart contract security and our tool called Securify. So given that not all of you might be familiar, what the hell is even a smart contract? Well, a smart contract is a very simple program running on the blockchain, hype alert. And mostly the most used blockchain is Ethereum. And why is smart contract security maybe a little bit different from, let's say, web security? What's special about it? Well, what's special about it is that the code is public, the state of the contract is public, and everyone can interact with the contract. So in a way, there's a lot of transparency, which is nice, but which also makes security harder, because it's relatively easy for the attacker. And finally, these handle a lot of funds, so they once you have a bug, you can typically easily monetize your bug. So is this a real problem or am I making this up? There have been sufficiently many big hacks. These numbers used to be a lot bigger, but now that the conversion rates dropped a little bit, the numbers don't look as impressive anymore, but you can definitely make some money if you know how to hack some smart contracts. So what can we do about it? At ETH Zurich, in cooperation with Chain Security, we built this new tool, which is called Securify. And first I will give a simple intuition into what it does. Basically, it provides some basic checks for your smart contract that you always want to have, like when your doctor comes with the stethoscope and does some basic checks on you. And if you are not so much into security, maybe you still have heard of Metasploit. So it's kind of like a Metasploit for smart contract. It scans for basic things that you always want to scan for. But now for those people who know a bit more about security and smart contracts, what's the more complex explanation of what's going on? Well, basically we built a dependency graph of the instructions inside and the variables and how the variables depend on each other and on the instructions and so on. And then we have certain patterns, security patterns, some we'll see later. For these we check for compliance and for violations. So in some situations we can say that things are definitely fine. In some situations we can say that things are most likely not fine at all. So what are these patterns? Oh, sorry. So one of them is reentrancy, which you might have heard about because it's what caused the famous DAO bug, which I listed one slide earlier. And another one is, for example, missing authorization, which is a very common problem in smart contracts because, as I said, everyone can interact with the smart contract. So by default, there's kind of everyone is the same to the smart contract, so you need to add a proper authorization feature system to the smart contract to ensure security. So really, we encourage all of you to try it out. It's fairly simple. You just put your code here and press scan now, and that's it. So please try it out. You find it under securify.ch. And as I said, it's free. It's a one-click analysis. You can either paste your code inside, you can upload a zip, or you can clone a Git. The Git clone feature in particular is a bit experimental at the moment. Definitely let us know if you see some issues with that. In general, we are super happy about feedback. And so if you want to learn more about what's going on behind the scenes, then you can read the academic paper that's been published that is letting you know more about what's happening there. It's all of this is open source, so you can go on GitHub, check it out. You can contribute, you can suggest new features. We are very happy for suggestions. You can, of course, report bugs. We are also very grateful if you do that. And I would like to take the opportunity to thank the Ethereum Foundation, which is making this possible. Finally, we have a Discord where you can contact us. We have a Twitter, and more features are coming soon. And lastly, let me say, if you're the guy scanning 4,000 contracts in the last few days, contact us. There's probably a better way for doing what you're doing. Thanks.
Next up is five contributors in online learner communities.
Okay, hello everyone. My name is Robert. I'm a software developer and I love to develop free and open source software. And I want to tell you how you can find contributors for your open source project. So this is not the slides that were updated. Can you please go? Can you maybe go to the C3LTD?
Yeah,
I'm sorry for that.
I'm also sorry. Maybe I downloaded the wrong.
I redownloaded this. Please, could you keep it closer to the podium? Because when your hands leave the podium, the microphone virtually will switch off.
All right.
Yes, that's it. Okay. So let's say you started your open source project and it usually looks like this. You're the lonely hacker who is sitting alone in the basement, working all alone, probably spending a lot of time. And I would say this is a problem because it's not very sustainable. And instead, I want to suggest to you that you should join an online learner community. A very simple online learner community match people who want to learn programming with those who are looking for contributors. If you want to know what learner community I'm in, that's Agile Ventures. You can go to their website, pretty simple. There are probably more like that out there. How does it work? We have, for example, regular meetings. This is a screenshot. We can hang out with each other and say hello to each other. And we can also work together and screen share. We do pair programmings. And for example, I'm always trying to teach some basic knowledge about programming, of course, answering questions, onboarding people as good as you can. All right, so I'm going to tell you in four steps what you can do if you consider to do that also. So the first thing that you should do is to set up a group chat. So since we are at Agile Ventures, we're using their Slack. You can choose whatever group chat you like, but it's cool because they have about 3,000 members. There's always someone new joining. If you want to sign up, there's also a link on the right side that will bring you to the sign up page. And then as a next step, you should set up a weekly meeting. And you should also consider the schedule. So our meeting takes place on Wednesday, 7 p.m. Central European time. And this is perfect for people from Europe and Africa. This is also good for people from North or South America, although there it's a little bit early, and if people are in their working times, they probably cannot join. For Asia and Australia, this is not so good because it's at nighttime, so we don't have people from there. So just consider that. The third thing that you should do, don't make your code a one-way. People are joining your project because they're interested into a certain technology or framework. So if you should definitely use popular frameworks because that will be one of the most important reasons why people want to join you. And as a last step, embrace non-code contributions. What you can see here is a chart of a GitHub blog from 2016 called The Shape of Open Source. And you see on the x-axis the number of contributors. And the more contributors you have, the non-code contributions increase, right? So the ratio goes over to the non-code contributions. And that's good, right? Because if you have more people will comment, more people will create issues, more people will do pull request reviews. That's something that you would not do if you work alone. And so you should be very thankful for everything that people give to you, including translations, documentations. You should have a really good README, by the way. So this is the last slide. I say spread the love. Everything will come back to you. Also consider if you have, for example, some degree in computer science, just consider that not everyone on this planet has access to public education. So you're really helping people if you join online learning communities, and some places on the earth, this is the only thing that they have, online courses, learner communities. If you want to see our pair programmings, there's a link to my YouTube channel where we put all the recordings of the pair programmings. This is all I have. Thank you very much.
So now next up is Santa's elf fingerprinting.
Hi guys. So in light of recent Christmas, so let's talk about a bit about elves. That's right. So I'm Gilly. I'm a security researcher and a co-founder of Kernel TLV, which is a kernel meetup in Tel Aviv in Israel. We'll discuss about deep Linux kernel things. And apart from that, if anyone wants after the convention, we can run a D&D one-shot. So we all know what elves are, right? These one executables that we run in the Linux kernel or any Nix-based operating system. And yeah, they're standard and it's really good document. You can see it right here. But why should we dissect these elves? What do we want from them? When I'm getting a new elf, I want to research it because I know when I want to attack it, I would not want to know what I'm facing. For example, do I have stack errors? Do I have ASLR? What will I face when I found my vulnerability? So it basically maps our attack surface and see what our competitors are doing, what our other vendors are doing. So we built an InspectElf. InspectElf is an open source on GitHub. You'll have the link soon enough. What we do, we want to detect everything that's related to compiler flags in Linux, in the Elf. So for example, once you just run it, you can get like whatever you want about position depend code, or whether this Elf is stack canary based, or if it's stripped, or various other heuristics, like whether it uses Google's ACE and address sanitizers, or get all the dependencies listings. You can find it here on GitHub, among other things. And there are some additional research about inspecting all the libraries and everything that you search through, so you can find additional versioning between different libraries and different elves. So for example, if you have one vulnerability in one version, you can find similarities within different version of the same elf. And the library does exactly that. It just matches according to this very nice research about how similar libraries are and how elves are similar to each other. And everything is compiled eventually to this one larger system. We call it libsearch. If you have a nicer name, then come up to me and give it to me. Basically, what we're doing here is we're mapping a lot of APKs and binaries so we can finally reverse search between them. So for example, if you have an APK, you can run it through our system and then get all the information that there is, like permissions, intents, libraries, compiler flags, versioning. And once you find a vulnerability that you want to research, then you can find it here and reverse search all the firmwares and APKs that that includes them. If you have any further questions, find me now, later, and thank you very much. Thank you.
Next up is alternative keyboard layouts.
All right, so hi everyone. I'm Sohalt at _Sohalt on Twitter, or there's also my webpage. Welcome to my talk on alternative keyboard layouts. First up, a little bit of history, because keyboards didn't always look the way we're used to. This, for example, is an old Telegraph keyboard, but our QWERTZ keyboard, as we know it, dates back to mechanical typewriters. These typewriters used levers to imprint the characters on the paper, and these levers would get stuck if you press keys that are close to each other at the same time. So that's why when designing QWERTY, they put keys or letters which are likely to appear after each other in the English language as far apart as possible to prevent these levers from jamming. In a way, you can say QWERTY was designed to be as inefficient as possible. With technological advancements, though, such as the IBM Typeball, Selectric, or now modern computers, we don't have these levers anymore, so no risk of jamming. But still, the layout mostly stuck around because people were already familiar with it. But let's actually look at some alternative layouts, because people still came up with alternatives. One even dates back to the time of mechanical typewriters. This patent is from the late 19th century and shows an alternative layout, but we're more interested in stuff that people still actually use today. So this, for example, is Dvorak. We also have Colmac, or my personal favorite, Neo2, which is optimized for the German language, because I'm German. What all of these have in common is that you can see that the most used keys, such as the vowels and the most used consonants, NRTD and so on, are placed center, so they're easy to reach and like directly under your fingers in the resting position. What's cool in addition about Neo is that it has multiple layers. And for example, on layer 3, you have all your parents, brackets, braces neatly arranged in pairs, which is super convenient for programming. So, but we can not only look, if you want to learn a new layout, I can recommend a type trainer like Ktouch, it's free and open source. But we can not only look at the arrangement of the letters on the keyboard, but also the physical layout of the keys. Here are some proprietary keyboards. What they all have in common, more or less, is that they're symmetric, because if you think about it, your hands are symmetric, and also some of them have the keys arranged in straight columns, because after all, your fingers are also straight and not bent in some weird way. These are all proprietary, so you can just buy them, but everything is closed source. There are also open source models. The top two have fully open hardware and software, so you can build the whole thing yourself. The top two, the bottom two you have to buy, but you can change the firmware, and everything is open source there. I have an address with me. If you want to try it out, come and find me later. There are still more crazy things, such as corded keyboards, where you would press multiple keys at the same time to produce a single keystroke, or interesting touch keyboards. And if you want to find out more, the Desk Authority and GeekHack forums provide all kinds of information. And also there's the Bill Buxton collection, which has a crazy collection of input devices, not only keyboards. The slides are online, and the links, like those are all links that are clickable. So yeah, if you want to find me, I'm mostly around the NixOS assembly. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Now to escape from my browser again. All right, next up is RefFS, the reverse SSHFS.
So, hello. So if you're like me, you're working on a laptop. Like most people travel around and have their data with me. So I have this problem. I can maintain stuff, and I speak at conferences and organize stuff. And if you're looking for a challenge, you try to have all your data with you, because at some point you're offline, you're in a tunnel or whatever. So I made this project. And brilliant as I am, I started at CCC, because that's where you have the most time to implement stuff. So, here's the goal. I don't want to have an SSH server running on my laptop and then break through some firewalls back into my machine. I want to have one folder that can expose on the remote end and have an interactive session, and maybe have session resumptions if I fall out of a VPN or any other network. So, as usual, when you under pressure, you start developing, and you start like, oh, I have this libssh2, systemcli, can also copy stuff. Then you think about practical problems while developing, like you have to copy over your binary, because, yeah, you have development and protocol changes. And then you realize stuff, oh, the Linux file system basically relies on inodes and UID git translations, so you need that as well. And that's where I took a step back and said, okay, I kind of failed at this rushing in. So to be able to reach my future goals, I would have to stop and redesign. And also talk to people and say, hey, I messed up this time. What would you do different? And especially for advanced features like remote disk cache, where you have a server with not that much RAM or just process terabytes of data, you might not want to have it go back and forth all the time. So we made a new design. First of all, we use Rust and not any scripting language, and split up the process into two binaries, the exporter, which is where you initiate your mount, reverse mount, and the mounter, which is running on the server side. So the mounter does not have any configuration. only started and possibly uniquely started every time. Interactive mode is something that some people like and some people hate. One of the designs is that we use Fuse on the remote end, which allows you to export your file system from Windows to Linux. So you can use Linux strength without, without having to worry where you're coming from, because the client binary runs on every major platform. And we also want to have a soft timeout on the server, so that the server binary, if it loses connection for like a minute or two, it says, okay, this probably failed. Let's clean up all the stuff. Okay, so if you're interested in this project, please follow the source code. If you want to help, please do. And if you're just interested and say, oh yeah, I can use that, you can also write me an email and say, hey, I would like to use it for this case. I would like to have this and that feature. And yeah, keeps me motivated to see people actually wanting to have this project. Oh, by the way, I have one giveaway. It's the plushie, it's Ferris, it's the mascot of Rust. So if anybody wants it, just raise your hands and I will throw it in the general direction. Okay, see you there. We'll see. Oh, sorry. Fight. No. Be kind. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Then next up is Radentscheid Darmstadt. And as far as I can see, the next five talks are going to be in German. So check out c3lingo.org for a translation and the instructions how to listen to the translations.
Letztes Jahr war ich hier und der Kongress hatte das Motto Tu wat. Ich habe mir das zum Anlass genommen und habe dieses Jahr was getan. Ich komme aus Darmstadt und da haben wir ein Problem, wie in vielen deutschen Städten. Dort ist es so, dass Radfahren nicht sicher ist. Und leider ist das Radfahren die einzige Modalität, die nicht sicher ist. Es ist keiner, der mit dem Auto gefahren ist, zu Tode gekommen. Niemand, der den öffentlichen Verkehr genutzt hat und auch zum Glück niemand, der zu Fuß ging. Nur das Radfahren hat 4 Todesopfer in den letzten 12 Monaten gefordert. Wir haben dann begonnen, dort Mahnwachen abzuhalten und zu sagen, wir als Zivilgesellschaft, wir akzeptieren nicht mehr, dass Menschen, die nur von A nach B kommen möchten, sich einer Todesgefahr aussetzen. Wir haben das gemacht, um den Angehörigen, Hinterbliebenen Mut zuzusprechen und auch uns selbst zu vergewissern, dass wir jetzt was tun müssen. Also haben wir uns 7 Ziele überlegt, wie können wir unsere Stadt zu einer besseren machen und haben uns vor allem angeschaut an den Punkten, wo es wirklich hakt, an den Hauptstraßen, an den Kreuzungen, wie kann das sicherer sein, und haben dort Ziele formuliert, die sowohl qualitativ sind, also wie genau sieht eine sichere Kreuzung aus, kann man nachlesen in unseren Unterschriftenlisten, genauso wie viele Kreuzungen sollen umgestaltet werden, damit Stadtverwaltung und Politik unter messbaren Druck gerät, binnen gewisser zeitlicher Fristen mengenmäßig etwas zu liefern. Unsere Formel zum Erfolg, die hat sich herauskristallisiert als Mut, Unbeirrbarkeit und Netzwerke. Manchmal muss man ein bisschen Mut haben, rauszugehen. Dann kommt auch Gegenwind. Und den muss man aushalten und zwar nicht stur, aber klug sein und sagen, wir machen trotzdem weiter. Und Netzwerke, das sind Freunde, Familie, NGOs, Verbände, aber auch über 70 Einzelhändlerinnen und Einzelhändler haben uns unterstützt auf dem Weg, haben Unterschriftenlisten ausgelegt. Dann sind wir rausgegangen, haben gesammelt für unsere Ziele Unterschriften für ein Bürgerbegehren. Wir haben demonstriert auf der Straße mit jungen Familien, Kindern, haben ihnen mal an einem Tag die Möglichkeit gegeben, unbeschwert mobil zu sein, auf ihren Fahrrädern ohne Angst haben zu müssen und zu zeigen, ihr seid nicht alleine, wir ändern jetzt was. Dann haben wir abgegeben, wir haben in 3 Monaten 11.000 Unterschriften gesammelt für ein formales Bürgerbegehren. Das sind 11.000 Unterschriften verglichen mit den Stimmen, die beispielsweise die Grünen erlangen in Darmstadt, die größte Fraktion stellen. Wären wir eine Partei, säßen wir quasi in Fraktionsstärke im Parlament. Und das hat natürlich Respekt denjenigen eingeflößt, die seit den letzten 7 Jahren, wo die Grünen mit der CDU zusammen regieren und die Grünen auch den Oberbürgermeister stellen, dass jetzt endlich was passieren muss, dass von warmen Worten nichts besser wird. Daraufhin hat die Regierung 4 Millionen Euro bewilligt pro Jahr, hat 4 neue Stellen im Sachgebiet Radmobilität geschaffen. Das bedeutet, dass dort neben dem Radverkehrsbeauftragten, der dieses Jahr erstmalig benannt wurde, und 3 Mitarbeitern ab 2019 4 weitere arbeiten. Diese insgesamt jetzt 8 Personen sind in der Lage, nicht nur Pläne zu machen, sie können auch Fördermittel einwerben, sie können die Projekte leiten und können endlich das Versprochene auch umsetzen. Parallel verhandeln wir mit der Stadtverwaltung, mit dem Radverkehrsbeauftragten, Dezernentin, mit Oberbürgermeister darüber, wie unsere Ziele umgesetzt werden können, da sie unsere Ziele zwar inhaltlich für gar nicht schlecht halten und auch mächtig Angst bekommen haben, aber sie unser Bürgerbegehren auch für unzulässig halten. Dagegen klagen wir, da wir glauben, dass die Begründung, das Stadtsäckel sei leer, unsere Forderungen seien nicht umsetzbar, einfach nicht hinzunehmen sind. Und deswegen ändern wir das jetzt. Wenn man mal vergleicht, vorher, wo standen wir etwa auf dem Niveau wie Hamburg, Köln, München, das sind die fast nicht mehr sichtbaren kleinen Ausschläge. Das waren 3 Euro pro Einwohner und Jahr, manche sagen auch 5. Das ist normal in Deutschland, mehr gibt man nicht aus für einen sicheren Radverkehr oder für Radverkehr im Allgemeinen. Dann die Frontrunner in internationaler Hinsicht, Amsterdam, Kopenhagen, die gerne zitiert werden, die geben heute so zwischen 11 und 36 Euro aus und plötzlich konnten wir unsere Stadt international vergleichbar aufstellen. Wir sind nicht allein, wir sind Teil einer bundesweiten Bewegung. In Ausgang nahmen die in Berlin. Dort wurde dieses Jahr das Mobilitätsgesetz erlassen, auch auf Druck der Zivilgesellschaft hin. Dann in Bamberg, jetzt Darmstadt und nach uns folgten Frankfurt, Kassel, Stuttgart. Wir haben auch auf dem Kongress hier mit vielen Leuten geredet, andere wollen das auch machen. Kommt auf uns zu, wir helfen gerne, wir erklären, was haben wir richtig gemacht, was haben wir falsch gemacht und dann kriegen wir bessere Städte, gesünder, lebenswerter, sicherer, einfacher und am Ende können Kinder wie alte Menschen selbstständig mobil sein, sind nicht angewiesen auf Eltern oder Fahrdienste, können eben ihre Ziele erreichen und wir glauben, dass es eben alle voranbringen kann.
Danke. Dann podcasterinnen.org.
Guten Morgen zusammen. Ich möchte euch heute das Projekt podcasterinnen.org vorstellen, was ich zusammen mit Nela Heise und Michaela Lehr auf den Weg gebracht habe. Bei uns, also ich bin ja nur ein Teil einer bestimmten Podcast-Bubble und bei uns heißt es immer noch so, Podcasts sind weiß und männlich und es wird nur über Technik geredet. Und da muss man sich mal fragen, wie kommt man überhaupt auf diese Idee? Ich habe ein Symbolbild mitgebracht von einer Veranstaltung und es ist nur, also es gibt viele Panels, die so besetzt sind. 5 Männer oder 6 Männer in dem Fall unterhalten sich über Podcasting. Meistens war meine Reaktion darauf eher ein Verkriechen oder traurig sein und mir denken, wieso kommen die Frauen nicht zu Wort? Am 27.03. diesen Jahres veränderte sich aber das Gefühl und ich hatte auf einmal eine unbändige Wut in mir. Und ich weiß deshalb so gut, dass es der 27.03. war, weil ich am 28.03. die Domain podcasterinnen.org gekauft habe. Und dann mit Michaela zusammen und mit Nela Heise angefangen habe, eben die Webseite aufzubauen. Wir sind jetzt seit dem 23.12. online und haben natürlich verschiedene Nutzergruppen, die wir ansprechen wollen. Zum einen möchten wir, dass Podcast-Produzentinnen und nicht-binäre Podcast-Personen sich bei uns im Profil anlegen oder Podcasterinnen, die in einem festen Team zusammen podcasten. Auf der anderen Seite nützt das ja alles nichts, wenn sich Profile angelegt werden, wenn niemand auf die Webseite kommt und dort sucht. Also hoffen wir natürlich darauf, dass Veranstalter von Panels, Vorträgen und Workshops auch auf die Seite kommen und nach den Podcasterinnen suchen. Unser Ziel ist einfach, dass wir solche All-Mail-Panels nicht mehr so oft sehen müssen wie bisher. Ich möchte auf einen Punkt ein bisschen näher eingehen, das sind die iTunes-Kategorien. iTunes hat insgesamt 67 Kategorien, die haben wir aufgelistet und Nela Heise hat die Frauenstimmen im Netzliste mal ausgewertet und verschlagwortet und daraufhin haben wir angefangen, feste Tags für unsere Webseite zu nutzen. Aber iTunes gibt es genau eine Kategorie unter Gesundheit, die sich mit Sexualität beschäftigt und alle Podcasts, die in irgendeiner Form sich mit Sexualität beschäftigen, müssen in diese eine Kategorie rein. Wir haben uns jetzt für 174 feste Tags entschieden und 12 davon beschäftigen sich mit Sexualität und Partnerschaft. So können sich zum Beispiel auch Podcasterinnen, die über Bisexualität oder über Queerness reden, dieses Schlagwort nutzen und können so viel besser gefunden werden. Im Gegensatz hat aber iTunes sie von den 67 Kategorien 8 Kategorien, die nur sich mit Religion beschäftigen. Es ist ja okay, wenn jede Religion ein eigenes Schlagwort hat oder eine eigene Kategorie, aber wir haben uns gefragt, warum für Sexualität dann alles unter eine Kategorie muss. Es gibt noch ein weiteres Beispiel, was ich noch interessanter fand, und zwar, dass auch Technologie irgendwie ein Riesensammelbecken ist. Wir haben jetzt 16 Tags, die sich mit Technik beschäftigen, zum Beispiel auch mit Netzkultur, Netzpolitik, Programmierung. Und wir hoffen einfach, dass viele verschiedene Frauen und Podcast-Personen sich irgendwo dort wiederfinden. Und wenn sie sich nicht dort wiederfinden, freuen wir uns auch über jede Anregung. Es kam jetzt auch schon ein bisschen zurück, dass noch ein paar Kategorien fehlen würden. Und die haben wir jetzt mittlerweile nachgearbeitet. Ich glaube, wir haben jetzt noch 177 Tags insgesamt. Unser Wunsch ist natürlich, dass solche Tweets nicht mehr so oft vorkommen. Das ist auch wieder nur ein Tweet von vielen, dass Podcaster sagen, wir möchten ja, wir hätten gerne öfter Frauen bei uns im Podcast, aber wir finden leider überhaupt keine. Und deswegen würden wir uns natürlich freuen, wenn sich viele bei uns anmelden und viele, die Podcasts und ein Spezialthema haben, eben zu uns kommen und auch danach bei uns suchen. Vielen Dank.
Danke. Dann kommt Open Legal Data.
Okay, hallo, ich bin Saskia, ich bin Mitgründerin der Initiative Open Legal Data. Und wir wollen mit offenen Daten die Justiz transparenter machen. Und zwar, indem wir freien Zugang zu juristischen Daten, Gesetzen, aber auch vor allem Urteilen schaffen wollen. Hauptanliegen ist es, dass wir juristische Daten mit technischen Mitteln verarbeiten, analysieren, um dadurch halt vor allem Nicht-Juristen auch Rechtsthemen näher zu bringen, also Aktivisten, Journalisten und Wissenschaftlern. Wie gesagt, Hauptanliegen sind erstmal vornehmlich Urteile. Jetzt hoffe ich, kriege ich das hin. Nein? Jetzt. Na, eine zu weit, genau. Unser Hauptanliegen sind Urteile, denn obwohl Urteile im Namen des Volkes ergehen, das ist sogar gesetzlich normiert, werden diese halt nicht frei zugänglich gemacht. Um also das mal zu konkretisieren und zu visualisieren, wir haben die Gerichtsverhandlungen, die ist öffentlich, wir haben die Urteilsverkündung, die ist öffentlich, aber am Ende, das Urteil wird häufig nicht veröffentlicht. Also man kann halt die Urteilsgründe als Normalperson danach sozusagen nicht einsehen. Das stellt sich auch problematisch für Journalisten dar, zum Beispiel, wenn ein Journalist über einen Fall berichtet und er will sich dann mit den Urteilsgründen auseinandersetzen, dann ist er entweder auf die Pressestelle angewiesen, kriegt ja dann eigentlich die Urteilsgründe aus zweiter Hand, oder kann aber die Herausgabe des Urteils verlangen, was mit viel Aufwand verbunden ist und sehr viel Zeit in Anspruch nimmt. Die Veröffentlichungspraxis in Deutschland ist derzeit sehr unbefriedigend. Lediglich 1,4% der Urteile werden veröffentlicht. Und obwohl es sogar grundgesetzlich verankert ist, dass es eine Amtspflicht gibt, Urteile zu veröffentlichen, was sogar auch das Bundesverfassungsgericht so sieht, wird dem halt in dem Sinne nicht nachgekommen. Nur dann, wenn ein Urteil veröffentlichungswürdig ist, kann der Richter von sich aus entscheiden, ob es veröffentlicht wird oder auch nicht. Veröffentlicht heißt auch nicht immer, dass es dann unbedingt auch gleich frei zugänglich ist, also im Sinne von Open Data, sondern dass die Urteile in kommerziellen Datenbanken angeboten werden, die auch natürlich erhebliche Kosten mit sich bringen. Diese Kosten leisten sich in der Regel Juristen, aber nicht unbedingt der Otto-Normalverbraucher, Journalisten, also einfach jedermann. Was wollen wir also? Warum freier Zugang zu juristischen Daten? Wir wollen die Rechtsprechung transparenter machen, indem wir also auch ein subjektives Rechtsempfinden durch objektive Urteilsdaten erklären können, ohne dabei natürlich den Blick für den Einzelfall zu verlieren. Wollen, weil die Rechtsprechung ein elementarer Bestandteil des Rechtsstaates auch ist, diese sichtbar machen. Wir sind der Ansicht, dass amtliche Werke wie Urteile nicht in die Hand privater Unternehmen gehören, sondern halt nach dem Grundsatz Public Money, Public Data zur Verfügung stehen sollten. Genau. Und was wir bereits schon machen, ist, dass wir bereits veröffentlichte Urteile sammeln und auch nicht veröffentlichte Urteile bei den Gerichten anfordern, was auch mit Aufwand verbunden ist und vor allen Dingen auch mit Kosten. Das heißt, wir sind auf eure Hilfe angewiesen, sammelt Urteile mit, schickt sie uns zu, fragt bei Gerichten unveröffentlichte Urteile an und ja, vor allen Dingen baut mit an der Open Data Plattform, den Source Code findet ihr unter GitHub. Und dann bedanke ich mich einfach für eure Aufmerksamkeit.
So, dann kommt Videoüberwachung im Schafstall.
Guten Morgen. Ich bin auf dem Land aufgewachsen, mitten im Nirgendwo. Da gibt es zwar inzwischen schnelles Internet, aber seit April auch ein paar Lämmer, also inzwischen größere Schafe. Und ja, weil ich irgendwie ein bisschen heimatverbunden bin und gerne noch da bin, zumindest am Wochenende, habe ich mir gedacht, ich möchte doch irgendwie diese Schafe ein bisschen im Überblick behalten. Und naja, dann habe ich mir so eine Billo China Webcam geklickt, weil für den Anfang ist das als Student das günstigste Mittel der Wahl. Die kann nicht viel, aber sie kann sich drehen. Was sie im Netzwerk macht, habe ich, soweit ich weiß, größtenteils unterbunden. Die habe ich dann in den Schafstall gehängt. Das war da recht einfach, weil der Schafstall ist direkt neben dem Hausgebäude und ich konnte über Power over Ethernet das Ganze verkabeln. Haben sich auch direkt ein paar Vögelchen mit draufgesetzt und das Ganze belebt. Dann habe ich aber gemerkt, okay, die Schafe sind recht wenig im Schafstall, gerade im Sommer dann gar nicht mehr. Also musste das Ganze irgendwie raus. Jetzt ist an so einem Haus praktischerweise von irgendwem mal eine Satellitenschüssel angebracht worden. Die benutze ich nicht, aber da kann man ja noch mehr anbringen, unter anderem Richtfunk. Und das habe ich getan. Der führt jetzt nach draußen zum 150 Meter entfernten Schafstall mitten auf der Weide. Und da kann ich jetzt die Schafe überwachen. Schafe sind ja recht anspruchslose Tiere, deswegen haben sie sich auch nicht gewerkschaftlich organisiert oder irgendwas bezüglich Datenschutz gesagt. Da habe ich die Webcam reingehängt, als erstes mit einer Powerbank, das hat aber immer nur so einen knappen Tag gehalten, das war mir dann irgendwann zu wenig. Also habe ich das Ganze auf Solar aufgestockt. Das Ganze läuft jetzt über dieses eine Solarpanel, das lag irgendwo noch rum, ich habe keine Ahnung, wem es gehört. Ein Solar-Laderegler für irgendwie 12, 13 Euro. Und ja, ein paar Kabel. Die Kamera hat so wunderbar den Sommer und Herbst über funktioniert. Im Winter war es jetzt ein bisschen kritischer. Der Empfang ist ein bisschen eingebrochen, aber auch da gab es eine Lösung. Funktioniert tatsächlich. Ja, und ich habe das Ganze jetzt so ein bisschen als Spaßprojekt nebenbei für mich gefunden und möchte damit weitermachen. Ziele für 2019 sind deswegen unter anderem der Ausbau zur Windkraft. Also ich möchte Solar und Windkraft kombinieren, weil unter anderem die Temperaturen und das wenige Licht in Herbst- und Wintermonaten dazu führen, dass die Kamera dann doch größtenteils offline ist, was natürlich schade ist. Da gibt es ein großartiges Projekt für eine selbstdruckbare Windturbine. Da hilft mir der Patrick ganz lieb. Er hat schon den Großteil der Teile gedruckt und ich werde mich da jetzt den Winter dran setzen und das Ganze zusammenstecken. Wenn dann ein bisschen Energie im Überfluss da sein sollte, dann möchte ich das Ganze auch noch mit einem Tränkenwärmer verbinden. Das ist im Winter natürlich ein Problem, wenn das Wasser einfriert draußen, dann haben die Schäfchen nichts zu trinken und es muss jeden Tag gewechselt werden. Wäre einfach eine Arbeitserleichterung. Und ja, mehrere Kameraperspektiven. Warum denn eigentlich nicht? Gibt es schöne, einfache Lösungen mit dem Raspberry Pi zum Beispiel. Da werde ich ein bisschen mich ausprobieren und ja, spielen. Und wenn das Ganze funktioniert und wenn das Ganze sinnvoll klappt, dann möchte ich auch gerne die Schafi-Cam einfach als Einschlafhilfe bereitstellen. Dann könnt ihr, die ihr vielleicht zu Hause liegt und keine Schafe habt, entspannt nachts Schäfchen zählen. Ob das Ganze funktioniert, wird sich im Laufe des nächsten Jahres zeigen. Ich berichte darüber gern beim nächsten Kongress. Wenn jemand Hilfe anbieten kann in Richtung Solar, Windkraft, Kombinierung des Ganzen und so weiter, meldet euch gern. Oder wenn ihr skurrile Ideen habt, wie man das Ganze noch weiter ausbauen kann. Die Schafe sind da, sie haben Spaß und ich auch. Also, Dankeschön.
Vielen Dank. Dann kommt Chaosbots.
Gehen beide? Ja, hallo. Mein Name ist Watz. Das ist der.
Ich bin der Cruncher.
Genau. Und wir beide. Ah, wir haben selbst. Ah, perfekt. Genau. Wir möchten gerne über die Chaosbots referieren. Und zwar, falls ihr vorhabt, irgendwie mal so ein Chaos-Treff zu gründen oder eine chaosnahe Gruppe bei euch zu etablieren, weil das jetzt beim Kongress euch so toll gefallen hat, aber ihr habt echt keine Ahnung, wie man das macht oder was, an wen man sich wenden kann und ihr möchtet euch einfach mal informieren und ihr sucht da irgendwie auch Anschluss oder egal, ihr habt irgendwie Fragen und möchtet die irgendwie beantwortet bekommen, dann gibt es die Chaosbots dafür. So, das Bot steht nicht für Roboter, sondern eigentlich für Botschafter. So, und was macht man da? Wo kriegt man die her? Wie findet man die? Da gibt es so diese CCC-Seite, die heißt regional. Und da findet man eine Liste der lokalen AFAs und der entsprechenden Chaos-Treffs. Und das sieht im Moment so aus. Das ist schon relativ gut, aber da seht ihr, dass da noch diverse weiße Flecken auf der Karte sind. Und da könnt ihr was dagegen unternehmen und da halt eben entsprechend Chaos-Treff oder irgendwas gründen. Ja? So, und ihr seht dann auch schon, wo dann so ungefähr regional euer nächster Alpha oder Chaos-Treff ist. Und dann könnt ihr bei denen da einfach mal einfach anfragen und sagen, wie komme ich da irgendwie, wie gründe ich so einen Verein oder irgendwie, wie komme ich da irgendwie günstig an Mate? dann sollte es da eigentlich einen Chaos-Bot geben. Und ja, wenn euch das irgendwie zu kompliziert ist, könnt ihr auch Folgendes machen. Ihr subscribt euch auf die Chaos-Treffs-Mailing-Liste. Das ist eigentlich relativ einfach, wenn man diesen drei Regeln folgt. Man schickt erst eine Mail an Chaos-Treffs-Subscribe, kriegt dann eine Bestätigungs-Mail und da steht so in der kleinen Zeile drin, dass man einen Reply schicken soll auf die E-Mail. Und ansonsten bitte nichts verändern. Wenn man das dann richtig macht, dann ist man auf einmal auf Chaos-Treffs-Ad und dann kann man da einfach eine E-Mail hinschicken. Und dann erreicht man so ziemlich eigentlich alle AFAs und Chaos-Treffs. Und man kann da immer Fragen stellen, wie zum Beispiel, ich bin in der Nähe von Paderborn, wo ist denn hier der nächste AFA-Chaos-Treff oder irgendjemand, mit dem ich mal über den CCC quatschen kann. Ja. Gut, was noch? Wir haben einen IRC-Channel, der heißt Raute Regio im Hackint. Da könnt ihr einfach auch joinen. Hackint hat mittlerweile auch ein Web IRC-Interface, das heißt, da könnt ihr einfach dann auf hackint.org gehen und da braucht ihr nicht mehr einen Client oder sowas, einfach im Browser und den Channel Regio eingeben und dann solltet ihr da sein. Ja, ansonsten, Cruncher wird euch jetzt ein bisschen informieren, was so ein Chaosbot eigentlich macht und da fehlt ein O. Ja, aber.
Ja, also wem das jetzt alles zu langweilig war, weil ihr schon euren Erfe habt, euren Chaos-Treff und wisst, wie das alles geht, dann seid ihr sehr gerne eingeladen, ein Chaosbot auch zu werden. Wir pflegen das aktuell vor allem mit einer Liste im Doku-Wiki. Da kann man sich eintragen, wenn was fehlt oder wenn man schon drin ist, kann man da auch entsprechende Chaosbots finden. Und wo das sehr schön ist, wenn man schon etabliert ist in seinem AFA, dann hat man vielleicht noch so, man fährt einmal im Monat beruflich in eine andere Stadt oder besucht mal irgendwo Leute und sieht, da gibt es vielleicht eher einen kleinen Chaos-Treff oder gibt es noch gar nichts. Da kann man dann entsprechend auch Hilfe anbieten, mal schauen, können die zu Erfer werden, kennen die sich mit dem Chaos überhaupt aus und ja, wie kann man die besser mit dem ganzen Chaos in Deutschland vernetzen. Da gibt es eben im Wiki diese eine Liste und auch im Wiki findet ihr unter...
Das ist doku.ccc.de, genau.
Ja, und unter doku.ccc.de Chaosbots findet ihr dann auch noch mehr Informationen, was man als Chaosbot machen kann, können, sollte oder wie man sich da am besten einfindet.
Ihr werdet feststellen, dass da gleich eine Passwortabfrage kommt. Das Passwort für das Doku-Wiki bekommt ihr natürlich dann von den Kollegen. Ja, das war's.
Ah, Sie haben die V2-Folie. We continue with the next talk, Force Asia, the 10-year journey.
Right. Yes. Hi, everyone. So. All right. Sure. Thanks. So yes. So hi, everyone. I'm Wei Tat. I'm from Singapore. I'll be taking place Hong Fook. She had a very exciting past 3 days, so she's slightly sick. Yeah. So I'm taking over her. Yeah. So So Force Asia is created and founded in 2009. So we have actually been contributing to a lot of open source projects, creating, and things like this. So these are some of our contributors. So the community is very big, consists of international communities, places from Singapore, India, and so on. Yep. And we also collaborate with makerspaces. Yeah. And these are some of our projects. One of it is a personal assistant, Suzy. So it's on my hand right now. I can pass this around later on. So it's built with Raspberry Pi. Yeah. It's a very straightforward open source voice assistant. We have projects like the PSLab.io, yeah, which is we'll talk about it later on, and yeah. So these are some of our events, upcoming events. One of it is our main largest event, which is held in Singapore, Open Tech Summit. So these are some of what we do to spread actually open source throughout the whole community and the entire world, especially in Asia as well. Yeah. If you're interested, you actually can just come along, see the website. And, yeah. So yeah, 2009 was the first GNOME meetup. Yeah, so this was it's held in Kanto, one of the cities in Mekong region. Yeah, and yeah, 2010 we had the first Debian mini meetup. About yeah, 2011 we had the first Barcamp in Mekong as well. So this was held in Kanto as well, yeah. 2012, we built our first hotel. This is an open source hotel. Everything is built from scratch, with solar power, internet. Everything is open source. We use open source technology to run the internet. Yeah, and 2013, we have a more workshop. We have science hack days in schools and Vietnam across schools and university across Vietnam. Yeah, this is to actually teach them more about open source and of course. Hack the way through, yeah. And 2014, we actually had our first. This is one of the partnerships. Not partnerships, I would say. With Jitten, this is one of the earlier versions of PS Labs, which we'll talk about it in the next talk. Yeah. So this was the birth. That was the birth of PS Lab. And 2015, we shifted the signature event from Vietnam to Singapore, which is held yearly actually. Now, the upcoming one. Yeah, so this is actually a gathering of international community speakers to share about their insights of open source. And yeah. Yeah, so 2016, we had our Code Heat program. So this was actually to let high school students to actually get a touch of coding and have a professional mentors who are experienced developers to guide students through. We also have events in India. Yeah, like this is a hack day, so you can see people are actually trying out different stuff, electronics, soldering, and yeah, we have also an open source laser cutter. If some of you actually went to the critical decentralization cluster, you'll see this as well, open source laser cutter. You can try it out. You can know more about it. Yeah. And 2017 was the last year. This was the CCC last year that we attended. Yeah, you can see that we actually quite. Actively in the open source community and the maker community as well. And Pocket Science Lab, this is like one of the projects that we actually, that was well developed with the community. So it's actually out in the market right now. We just got it out this year, a few months ago. Yeah, so what it does is actually it makes all these scientific instruments that you can find in science labs within one device. It's just a very simple plug and go on your Android phone. And of course, we have a Linux desktop app as well. And of course, these are some of the upcoming events that we'll be attending. We'll be glad that you join us as well. Yeah. FOSDEM is the upcoming one, which is in February. And yep, another bigger one will be in March, which is in Singapore, the Force Asia Summit. And so with that, I end. Yeah, about Force Asia 10th anniversary. Thank you.
Thank you. Right. right. I've seen this somewhere.
Oh, okay. Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah, I have the honor here to talk about the PS Lab specifically. So my name is Mario. I'm also like based a lot of my time in Asia, and so we're cooperating on the Pocket Science Lab with a community around the world. The Pocket Science Lab is a USB-powered smartphone extension, open hardware device. So every layer must be open. Science, well, I'm always a bit confused about science as open science, because in my view, science should always be open entirely. So what is it? Yeah, it's a hardware, and it has an array of useful control and measurement tools. So it can be accessed through the phone, but actually we also have a desktop app that is in Python, or you can just build your own apps. You can connect to the device using the UART USB standard, so that's all possible. Then there are different pins that you can connect to and make any kinds of measurements. So yeah, here is a picture. There, for example, with our smartphone app that's connected through the USB, and it also powers the device. This is here an earlier version, for example, and on the left-hand side you see how the app looks like. So here are a few details. So for example, in oscilloscope, we have a power source component. We have a multimeter, logic analyzer, wave generator, but we're adding more and more instruments. Also, some instruments can access, for example, the sensors of the phone, like a lux meter. And if you would like to have any more instruments implemented or have any other ideas, please talk to us, and we'll do it very quickly. So. We're releasing usually around every 1 to 2 weeks a new version, so development is really active. So there's a lot of development. The project has been developed for 3 years, and we have had different form factors, but we thought like the best one is the Arduino Mega, and the last Arduino Mega like size kind of form factor. And the latest version supports Bluetooth, supports ESP also. There are many small gadgets, like some information for newbies, and we added more digital pins. This is how the desktop app looks like. Has like more than 50 scientific experiments that you can run through as well. So a goal for the future is also to make it easier to install. Right now it's like mainly geared towards Linux desktops. I saw some people like running it on Windows, but it's not so easy to set up. So this is something we want to make easy in future. Unfortunately, still a lot of schools run with Windows on their desktop machines. So this is something we unfortunately cannot change ourselves within the project. So as the background, you just heard the talk about FOSS Asia. And so it's developed with the FOSS Asia community together, this project, but also we have developers in Germany and in the US. So yeah, a lot of people from all over the world. And actually these are similar slides, but like we have also partners with a more commercially focused background. For example, the Fraunhofer Institute here in Germany, they have a startup factory. And because like it's not just a community project, you actually need to produce the hardware, you need to come up with money, with funding, you need to send somebody to deal with the manufacturers. So and that is an advantage for us, as we have many members in Asia, so it's also easier to communicate with us with like manufacturers in Asia, for example. But like here in Germany, we have the support of the Fraunhofer Institute, and they helped us a lot to improve the device, for example, to extend the longevity of the device, so that, for example, it doesn't work only for 2 years, it could work maybe up to 10 years, so it's also better for the environment. WeTat was in Shenzhen and took care of the production there. There are a lot of lessons learned, and I can't go into detail, but I will share the slides. So anyone who would like to produce their own hardware, please come to us. We're also like very actively sharing with like famous open hardware guys here in the community. Mitch Altman is a mentor in the community. Bunny Huang gave us a lot of good feedback, and a lot of learnings we had ourselves here, and yeah, please come to us. For example, here's a small picture of like if you get reels, yeah, to produce something. So you really need to check that all components are fine. And yeah, lots of lessons learned to be shared. I'm at the end of the talk. We have a roadmap, which means like we also want to have a web app, for example. So that's something we do in future. We're doing workshops, tutorial, education, and please talk to us about how we can collaborate or what you want to do or build your own apps and yeah, use it. We have a few devices here at the workshop at the FOSS Asia booth. So please come to us and yeah, start to work together. Thank you very much.
All right, next up is software accessibility. What could possibly go wrong?
Just as a little heads up, this is actually going to be a German talk, so I'm very sorry if you don't understand, please use the translations. Okay, wir müssen reden über Software Accessibility und was da schief gehen kann. Denn ich als sehbehinderter Computer und manchmal Screenreader-Benutzer stoße oft auf verschiedene Fehler, die so verschiedene Projekte implementieren, das tatsächlich nicht sein muss. Deswegen werde ich euch heute einfach mal 5 Dinge vorstellen, die mir persönlich relativ häufig über den Weg laufen. Und ich möchte gerne anfangen mit Bildbeschreibung. Wenn ihr mal im Internet nach Bildern sucht, dann ist es schon eine Rarität, dass Bilder mal tatsächlich irgendwie beschrieben sind. Und wenn sie dann beschrieben sind, findet man in diesen Bildbeschreibungen oft irrelevante Informationen oder Informationen, die nicht auf diesen Bildern tatsächlich zu sehen sind. Ne, ganz wichtig ist es, dass man in Bildbeschreibungen einfach nur diese Dinge listet, die tatsächlich auf dem Bild zu sehen sind und auch die wichtigsten Dinge auf diesem Bild als allererstes nennt. Denn Screenreader-Benutzer gehen in der UI immer nur einen Schritt vorwärts. Okay, gehen wir weiter. Das mit dem einen Schritt vorwärts ist wichtig für die nächste Folie. Denn diese UI muss auch hinter den Kulissen so aufgebaut sein, dass sie logisch einen Sinn ergibt. Man darf nicht einfach aus dem einen Kontext in einen komplett anderen springen und dazu ist es wichtig, diese Elemente einfach ordentlich zu labeln. Und wenn man sein Interface dann auch noch lokalisiert, dann sollte man diese Label bitte auch auf jeden Fall lokalisieren, denn ansonsten hat man nachher einen Mischmasch von Sprachen und das ist tatsächlich sehr, sehr verwirrend. Bitte auch, wenn der User irgendeine Aktion ausführt, den Fokus ändern, falls da irgendwas passiert und der User nicht in der App in einem komplett anderen Kontext ist als vorher. Die Label sollten bitte auch Sinn ergeben. Beim Spiegel hat man da oben zum Beispiel das Hamburger-Icon, hat zwar einen Wikipedia-Eintrag, ist aber für den otto-normalen Nutzer nicht gerade verständlich. Und bitte feiert euch auch nicht in euren Jobanzeigen für Accessibility-Testing, das nicht stattfindet. Das ist nicht gut. Dann Social Media. In Social Media-Netzwerken gibt es tatsächlich oft die Option, Bildbeschreibungen zu verfassen. Diese Bildbeschreibungen helfen blinden und sehbehinderten Nutzern zu verstehen, was man auf eurem Bild seht, das ihr postet. Leider ist es aber zum Beispiel bei Twitter so, dass diese Funktionen versteckt werden. Die werden in Accessibility-Menüs versteckt, das heißt, Otto-Normalverbraucher werden diese Option niemals finden, weil sie einfach denken werden, dass sie nicht wirklich relevant für sie sind. Bei Twitter ist es auch so, das Ganze ist standardmäßig deaktiviert. Bitte tut sowas nicht, sondern gibt den Nutzern direkt die Möglichkeit, irgendwie Bildbeschreibung zu verfassen, wenn sie selbst Content bei euch posten können. Das ist einfach wichtig. Und wenn ihr selber Accessibility-Features bauen wollt für eure App, dann stellt bitte auch sicher, dass ihr erstmal in den Operating-System-Optionen schaut, ob das da vielleicht schon implementiert ist und ob ihr die Einstellung da irgendwo herziehen könnt. Genau, apropos diese redundanten Informationen, das ist relativ häufig, zum Beispiel beim Spiegel hier. In der Mitte sieht man das an der Folie relativ gut. Da hat das Bild von dem Artikel genau denselben Text wie diese Artikelüberschrift. Bitte vermeidet sowas. Nimmt zum Beispiel das Bild aus dem fokussbaren Content raus. Das ist einfach nicht relevant, wenn wir da zweimal dasselbe hören. Wenn wir, wie gesagt, wir können nur eine Sache gleichzeitig hören. Und diese eine Sache wollen wir nicht zweimal hören, wenn wir sie schon überspringen. Und bitte stellt deswegen auch sicher, dass wir wirklich alles das erreichen können, was relevant ist für die Benutzung der App. Denn es könnte passieren, dass die App dann für uns im Endeffekt komplett nutzlos wird. Das ist auch ganz wichtig, wenn ihr irgendwelche Kommunikationsdienste baut. Kommunikationsdienste, ne, damit kommunizieren Menschen, da können Communities sich austauschen zu irgendwas. Und es ist mir persönlich schon passiert, dass, dass Communities, in der ich Teil war, dorthin gewechselt sind zu solchen Plattformen und man dann und man sich dann ziemlich ausgeschlossen fühlt, da einfach nicht Rücksicht drauf genommen wird, wer diese Community denn benutzen kann, wer diese Plattform denn nutzen kann. Zum Beispiel bei Telegram. Telegram ist in vielen Teilen der Welt sehr, sehr bekannt und sehr, sehr weit verbreitet. Also stellt bitte einfach sicher, dass die Leute das benutzen können. Nicht nur Screenreader-Nutzer sind davon betroffen, sondern auch Leute, die Switch-Controls benutzen, die eben nicht Touchscreens oder traditionelle Peripherie benutzen können. Also nochmal eine größere Gruppe, bitte stellt sicher, dass das für alle zugänglich ist. Bitte kontaktiert mich über E-Mail oder über Deckt hier, wenn ihr Fragen habt. Vielen Dank.
Next up is how to generate insight using text network analysis.
Hello everyone, my name is Dimitri, I'm from Nondus Labs, and I'm going to talk about how to generate insight using text network analysis. First I'm going to explain a little bit about how it works, and then I'm going to show you what you can do with it. Everything that I'm going to show today is made using InfraNodus app. It's available online, it's open source, it's on GitHub. So if you find this subject interesting and you want to contribute in developing it, please let me know. So everything I'm going to say today is going to be visualized on the graph. I didn't yet find a way to embed it into PDFs, so I just made slides with it, how it would work naturally. So every word can be represented as a node, and every co-occurrence of words is a connection between them. Once you have several words and they form sentences, a more complex structure starts to appear. In order to make this structure more readable, we can apply force atlas layout, which pushes the most connected nodes away from each other, while pulling together the nodes that tend to be connected to them. We can also apply community detection algorithm, which will indicate which nodes or words are densely connected together than with the rest of the network. So we can show each community with a distinct color. Using this information, I can already see that there are some main clusters of topics inside and how they're connected. So it's like an advanced version of Tech Cloud, but the one where you can not only see the most influential words, but also the context where they appear. I can also zoom in and learn more about a certain topic. I can also click on certain words and nodes and see which statements or context they appear in, so it becomes like a very useful tool for nonlinear reading. You can also do it with videos, for example, use the tool to visualize a subtitled video and then quickly zoom into the part of the video that you're interested in, so you don't have to watch the whole thing. And then switch to another video, maybe, which has a similar constellation of topics. I didn't mention it yet, but the nodes or words that are bigger on the graph are the ones that have the higher between a centrality measure. So these are the nodes that appear most often on shortest path between any two randomly chosen nodes in the network. So for example, the word mention was not mentioned so often, but it's quite prominent in the graph because it connects different communities together. And you have to go through this word in order to understand what the discourse is about. So it's like a junction of meaning inside the text. And you can see it using text network analysis as well. Also, what we can see from the structure of the text is the general network structure of the discourse, and that allows you to see, for example, how diversified, biased, or how dispersed it is. In this case, you can see the analytics pane on the right. It shows that the discourse structure is diversified, so it means that there are several different topics which are distinct from one another but are still connected. If you put in, for example, poetry inside the tool, it's going to be much more dispersed, and this is what poetry often is. It just presents us ideas for us to fill in the gaps, and it's nice that you can see it using this kind of tools as well. Another thing that you can do is to generate insight from text network structure. So you identify two communities that are not so well connected together, and you find a structural gap between them, and then you ask a question that would allow you to link them together. So for example, in this case, it would be how the notion of force structure layout connects to the idea of topical clusters, and then hopefully it can help you generate new ideas and think of something you haven't thought of before. So structural gaps are new ideas. Finally, what you can also do with the tool is just to create a nice abstract visualization of your thought. So I like it because it's kind of like showing you how thinking something is just creating constellations and throwing them out in space for others to connect with. So it can also be like a nice visual tool to show how thinking, discourse, and yeah, thought works. I will have a session today at 3:10. It's at M1, not at M3. I made a mistake in the slide. If you want to talk more about this tool, and if you want to discuss in general cognitive stimulation interface, the software that stimulates your imagination, yes, thank you. I hope that I will see you again.
Thank you. So it's M1, not M3. Next up is Hackers Against Climate Change. Full screen, go.
Hello. Climate change is real, and sometimes when we communicate to others, we need to have a certain concrete arguments, because hey, there are many very sensible feedback loops, and if we do not act now, the compound effects will effectively create an escape velocity. Just like longevity escape velocity, where every year your expected lifespan is increasing more than a year, there are many sensitive mechanisms, such as white polar caps, they are reflecting heat, and dark ocean water absorbs the heat. These are natural gases in Siberia, the natural methane, because the permanent frost is melting, the gas is released to the atmosphere. This is the ocean acidification, very sensitive mechanism. We have forest fires, more CO2 and less forests. This is also the deforestation, which means there is less water in the soil, there is less food produced, so people cut more forest to get more food, which is, this is a vicious circle. And these are just a few examples, the Aral Sea, the Chad Lake. The 2014 was the hottest year, 2015 was the hottest, and then, 2016 was the hottest year again and again. And 2017 wasn't the hottest, it was like a top three. 2018 is also top three, but it is complete mess, complete disaster. And it is what I'm trying to say is the climate change is real and it is affecting everyone across the planet. And us as hackers, we need to collaborate together with decision makers and politicians. And when we talk with anyone, we should have this arsenal of points, such as it is affecting everyone. Islands on the Pacific, it is affecting Bangladesh, which is situated, very poor country, in the river delta, only a few meters above the sea level. The hurricanes on the Atlantic Ocean, which is a pure physics. There is so much heat, so much energy accumulated in the water, and the hurricane happens when there is a difference in pressures. It's just the basic physics. Global warming means more fierce natural disasters. Of course, Africa, drought, not enough water. And the very recent example with the Syrian refugees, which was also created by the climate change. People migrated to cities, there was not enough jobs, they were, struggling. This whole migrant crisis is triggered by the global warming. And even if you are not directly affected by it, if you are, say, Sweden, because Sweden is, far in the north, they are not affected, but you are affected indirectly because of the waves of refugees. I just said that you are not affected directly, but actually you are affected directly as well, because these heat waves, etc., etc., etc. There are people organizing together the grassroots movements, the Extinction Rebellion. We try to influence politicians, but maybe we can actually become politicians ourselves. We can vote, we can go to European Parliament. This is a very notable example. president of the Young Pirates of Europe, and I believe that hackers and pirates, we should act together, we should help our people get into the parliament, and hey, if we want to change the, say, privacy and open source, why not just go to the government and us becoming the government, us going to the parliament, us pushing this open source, privacy, free software movement, and we can implement the democracy OS, we can just use the technology. And today there is a session, Hackers Against Climate Change. We met on day one, on day two, on day three. And in my country, if you want someone to do something, you need to say that to them, you cannot do this. It's too late to change anything. I cannot do anything about it. So these are not the true statements. I invite you to go to this session, Hackers Against Climate Change. There is a hashtag. Please, climate change is for real and it's affecting everyone. Thank you.
Next up is a really long title. Open hardware and free software camera for long-range 3D perception enhanced by neural network. PowerPoint karaoke.
It's a real challenge, I think.
It's a lot of pictures, at least. Meow. Okay. Obviously, the talker didn't show up, so we'll just continue with the next talk, which is going to be GNU Linux. Why we need GNU Linux on mobile devices. I'm just right now noticing that this is just a single slide. I think you sent me an update, right? Yeah, okay. Let's see. Very unprofessional of me. But something needs to go wrong at least once a Congress. Let me just check my mails. Or did you upload it in the system? Ah, okay. That's a lot faster then. So maybe I can show it on the big screen. The lightning talks are... I mean, I have 5 minutes now because the previous talk I didn't. So we have c3lt.de where you can check out all the talks that were submitted here and scheduled. We have a conference schedule because we are basically a small conference here. And so now we have open hardware and free software camera. We use this one. No, we don't use this one because he didn't show up. And we take this one.
I guess it was looking out for the talk. You have seen all the talks here in the system, and it's a tremendous amount of work just preparing those talks. So please give a big round of applause to Jetzik.
So for all the consultants, it's called a single point of failure. All right, now, there we have it.
Okay, thank you. Let's talk GNU Linux on mobile devices and why we need it more than ever. So this is the mobile operating system market right now. Depending who you ask, we have 10 to 20% of iOS, and the rest, of course, is dominated by Android. Other players don't have a significant role in the market right now. So let's just skip iOS entirely, but Android, you might say, okay, of course we like FOSS, and Android is FOSS, right? Well, it's not that easy, and let's look why Android is not an option for us. So in recent development in Android, we see more and more crucial features being moved to Google Mobile Services, which is proprietary, and increasingly this includes security features. Another big problem in Android is that every device has its own patched Linux kernel, and for older devices also you have an entirely modified Android open source project, so all the open source components are different on every device as well. Another big problem is many devices are very, very locked down, so you can't just install any Android ROM you want. It has to be ported to the device specifically. And at this day, we don't have a single fully functional Android device that doesn't have any proprietary software in it, so you always have some proprietary components, or you have to skip some functionality, so you don't have Wi-Fi, for example. And another very, very big problem with Android is that it's owned by Google. Of course, I don't want to be that strict about it. Google is not per se evil, but Google is a very powerful company. And what we see, what we learned in 2016 is that Google is working on a new operating system called Fuchsia, and they have a new kernel for it called the Zircon kernel. And it's potentially very dangerous to the way mobile operating systems work right now, because the Zircon kernel is not GPL licensed, it's permissively licensed. So a hardware vendor could just adapt the kernel to its device and ship it and just not publish its changes. So you would end up with without any knowledge of how the kernel was changed. Right now, for all Android devices, we have the kernel, so we can look at what was changed to enable this device. It's a great help to get a third-party operating system on that device. So let's think about that. What would happen if we had a permissively licensed kernel and a proprietary user land on phones? Does that sound familiar? Yeah, that's exactly what iOS is. So Fuchsia could, in fact, turn Android into iOS, and that could be potentially very dangerous. So where do we go from here? Obviously, we have to get rid of Android. We have to replace it with what we know and love on the desktop, and that is Linux with GNU components. So let's look at some interesting projects that could help us on this path to GNU Linux on mobile devices. One interesting one is Anbox. It's Android in a box. It allows you to run Android apps on GNU Linux without any performance overhead. So you have many, many great free and open source Android apps, and you, of course, you don't want to lose them. So Anbox is a project that would allow you to continue to use these apps and not lose all the hours that were invested there. Another one that will allow us to use Android hardware with GNU Linux is the Halium project. What the Halium project does is it creates a unified hardware abstraction layer for GNU Linux operating systems to run with Android drivers. So Android doesn't use the glibc library we use on GNU Linux. It uses the Bionic library, and Halium bridges this gap and allows you to use a normal GNU Linux distribution on some Android devices. And it's a collaborative approach to allow for multiple operating systems to work on Android devices. These are two operating systems in development right now, traditional GNU Linux operating systems that already work on phones. Ubuntu Touch, in fact, you can already use as a daily driver. Of course, you have to like suffering a little, but it is possible to use it as a daily driver. Plasma Mobile, not entirely yet, but it's getting there. These are two commercial devices in development right now. Purism is a company that's focused on making an entirely free and open source phone. And Pine is originally a Raspberry Pi-like device that is going also to be made into a phone. So these are some domains, URLs of some projects that could potentially help us in this way. So please, if you have time to spare, go to these projects and contribute, because Fuchsia is potentially very, very dangerous to our way of life.
Next up is not this one, but Women in Cybersecurity Community Amsterdam.
Hello. Hi, everybody. So I'm here to give you a short introduction about WICA, Women in Cybersecurity Community Amsterdam. And this is a new Dutch initiative to create a women-only InfoSec group. So this is what I'm going to cover in the next 5 minutes: who, what, where, why. And I'm going to start with the why, because why not? Obviously, there is this lack of representation, of female representation in the InfoSec community and in tech in general, but this is not the main idea behind this. There is actually a few weeks ago, I was at a women-only tech event in Brussels, and it was just something completely different than what I'm used to, because hacker conferences, it's mostly male. And here I was surrounded by fellow techie ladies making geeky jokes and everything, and it just felt really nice. It was just something different, a completely different vibe. And this is basically what inspired me to look for women-only InfoSec groups in the Netherlands. So I asked Twitter and I asked friends around me to tell me if they knew any groups of hacker ladies. And basically, there was nothing. There used to be one group in the Netherlands, but it's no longer active, unfortunately. So I was like, okay, what am I gonna do now? Well, why don't I just create my own? And this is how Wicca was born. And basically, this is our meetup page. So we started this with a friend of mine, and we want to do monthly meetups where women will get together and talk about InfoSec. So who are we? Who's in with me on this? So Andrash Terra, she's a security consultant at Deloitte. And she basically does security assessments, pen testing. And I work as an ethical hacker for KPN, the Royal Dutch Telecom. And I do also pen testing, a little bit of red teaming. And yeah, basically that. So now, what is our goal as Wicca? So like I said before, we're just a circle for ladies in InfoSec in the Netherlands. And we want to create a safe space for women to meet and learn with each other and discuss basically all things InfoSec. And because we love to make bad crypto jokes and geeky jokes, this is what we'll be doing every month. And also one thing I would like to add is that while this is the audience, the target audience is women, we also want to say that we welcome anybody who feels the need to for a safe space away from the majority. So that is transgender women, non-binary, and others, you are welcome as well. So this is our first meetup, 31st of January. We're going to be talking about the machine learning challenges in incident detection. And Andrea is going to present on OSINT, gathering OSINT on the dark web. She did some really cool stuff. So if you are ever in Amsterdam or in the Netherlands and you want to, and Wicca is something for you, then please join us and present your research or make bad Unix jokes. So thank you. This was actually really short. If you have any suggestions, well, contact us on Twitter or on the Meetup page. And I hope that this speaks to you. Thank you.
Let's move that browser away because I don't want it. Want you to see my bookmarks. all right, then next up is OpenID authentication using OpenID Connect.
Yeah, good day. Good day, everybody. Yeah, my name is Benny Botz. Yeah, and I would like to introduce you into authentication using OpenID Connect and hope to encourage you to try it on your own afterwards. Yeah, let's start. How does authentication, especially web authentication, works nowadays? So you might know that. So you're protecting or try to protect your application using a reverse proxy. And this authenticating reverse proxy is then in charge to authenticate your users and permit them to or grant them to access the application. This has some drawbacks. You have some kind of tight coupling. And your developers must have, let's say, knowledge of your security infrastructure, which could be a problem for you if it comes to, let's say, least privileges. Yeah, and for that reason, I would like to introduce you a little bit into OpenID Connect. It's an authorization framework based off on known technologies, OAuth2 and JWT. It's using REST and JSON flows to ensure you can provide a secure way to identify your users. At the end of the day, you're receiving some kind of signed token, which is identifying your users. You can see where you can find also some specification. Well, how does it work? That's a very high level diagram in how it works. Usually, you have identity provider. He's in charge to authenticate the user. On the other side, you have also application or resource provider. This is serving this the service. And the user would like to access the application. Then the application sees, okay, you're not authenticated by now, I don't know you, so you're getting redirected back to the identity provider on the right, and there's the user authenticating. If he has passed in his credentials and those are successful, he's getting back using so-called authorization code. With that, is the application able to fetch or issue the token. One simple example, but let's go a little bit more in detail. What is that token about? Usually these tokens are transmitted using HTTP and encoded in using Base64. And if you like to decode that, you can do it online or using some, let's say, libraries. And at the end of the day, you will receive some kind of JSON, which a usual or normal web application is able to parse. And then you are able to fetch, let's say, email and whatever information you need for your application. That's more or less what is about that token. And why do you need that? So it's mobile friendly, very easy to integrate. It's also offering a user info service. For example, if you need to, let's say, fetch more information from that identity system, from that user, you're able to do so. And you also have consent. You know that very likely if you're using some web apps online, you need to grant, or you're able to grant the application to use the information from the identity provider. And with that, you're supporting developers to create applications without knowing their, let's say, their end user credentials, which is also really nice, I guess. Yeah, and how do you use it? You can install that on your own. There are several projects online. Let's have listed three of them here, so Keycloak, Dex, or Hydra. Just following the Getting Started guides. That's really a recommendation from me to set it up. And then on your application side, so you have a lot of choices. More or less every programming language you can use, for example, Go IDC or PyODC, or use some kind of, let's say, reverse proxy for here, for example, KDE JWT or Keycloak Gatekeeper. Yeah, and if you would like to do that, or try at least right now how it feels, try that simple web app. Yeah, and now it's using Google's identity provider as a, let's say, example. So let's be a little bit concise what you're doing, but you can try that, and a little bit of source code you also can find there. Yeah, thanks for that and enjoy.
Thank you. Next talk is Mathematicians plus Ethics equals Error 404.
Thank you. So my name is Maurice Kyoto. I'm a postdoctoral researcher in mathematics at Cambridge. I work on algebra and logic. And in my spare time, I try and tell mathematicians that they should probably behave. So, what do I mean by this? Well, mathematicians play a crucial role in designing the key processes behind the operation of the following fairly large and important organizations. So if you think about Google, which decides what you see on the internet, or Cambridge Analytica, we've heard some talks about at CCC already, who influence how you vote. Tinder, who decides who you, Amazon decides what you buy. Your bank decides on your loan, the NSA sees everything about you, and Facebook that knows everything about you. And there's a difference there. Yet, even with all of this influence, mathematicians receive no ethical training. They have vast amounts of influence on the way the world is working. That's increasing by the day. But no one ever tells them they should think about the impact of their mathematical work. So, do you see a problem? So how do mathematicians react to this? Well, I'd like to tell you that they're engaging with this, taking it on board, realizing that their work has serious impact, and trying to come up with ways to figure out how to assess that and talk to each other about it. But that's not what's really happening. Their actual response is something closer to this, which is, they don't want to hear it, they don't want to know it, go away, don't talk to me. See a problem? Well, I did. So what do I mean by, you know, sticking your head in the sand? Well, here are two examples. Firstly, mathematicians don't always appreciate or care about the impact of their work. They like to think and believe that, well, I just do the math. This stuff's not my problem. I've even asked a mathematician, so I spoke to a postdoc in math, and I asked him, if you found a fast factorization algorithm, would you publish it? And his response was, well, yes, of course, immediately. And I said, well, you do realize the damage that this would do if you published it without warning. And his response was quite remarkable. He said, it's my right to publish any work I do. It's their fault for using RSA. It's not my problem. Perhaps not quite realizing that publishing fast factorization just like that would pretty much disrupt the entire food supply chain in the world. See a problem? This is a community that doesn't really have an appreciation or understanding that its work can and often does cause real harm. And we saw a big example of this with Cambridge Analytica a few months ago, populated by data scientists, many of whom are mathematicians. So let's look at some academics. So they simply don't care about this. They see it as a waste of their time. And I've spoken to some academics and said, well, asked one in particular, do you think you should teach ethics to mathematicians? The response is quite clear. Well, no one else is doing it, so why should I? Anyway, it's a matter of opinion. We can't teach ethics to mathematicians because it's not a formula. It's not an axiom. It's just an opinion. We're mathematicians. We don't do opinions. We do exact truth. And so I said, okay, well, do you think I should teach ethics to mathematicians? And the response was quite clearly, your time will be better spent on your research. So this is a community that doesn't want to hear about it, doesn't want to know about it, doesn't want to speak about it, and doesn't encourage anyone else to speak about it. See a problem? If you do see a problem and you want to help on this sort of project, please get in touch. I've been working with a small number of collaborators in mathematics, a very small number because the community doesn't really want to hear it. We've been organizing meetings, writing discussion papers, guiding a student society, investigating case studies, giving talks, and developing teaching resources. Because at the moment, if you try and look up teaching resources for ethics in math, there is practically nothing. The field doesn't exist. Other disciplines it exists in. Computer science, law, medicine, the understanding of ethics is quite present because they realize that their professions can have serious impact on the world. Mathematics hasn't been done yet. But this stuff is not enough. I need a lot more help to get the mathematics community to engage with ethics. A lot more help from people like yourselves, who do have an understanding that technical work, even though it seems abstract, can have a real impact on society. So please do get in touch. We have a student society in Cambridge that's working on this, and also a centrally funded university project to develop teaching resources and other ideas on this. So if this is of interest to you, please get in touch. Thank you.
Next up is Sailing to the New Paradigm.
Hello, my name's Liam from Astral Ship, and I'm going to talk about the project I've been working on for the last sort of 8 years that's taking shape. And it's basically a kind of accelerator for alternative projects and a way to create an alternative world that I think is possible. In 2010, I bought a chapel in Wales for £75,000, and the same year I also went sailed to Ireland. And the sailing experience really gave me a sense of what it means to have sovereignty and what perhaps pirates, as we call them, maybe felt when they owned their own ship and were free to go wherever they wanted on the seas. Pirates historically are quite interesting. I think they're probably quite appealing to people here.
And they brought a lot of innovations. There's a guy who wrote a book recently called Be More Pirate that's kind of circulating a bit in the more corporate world. And he gives a lot of arguments for why pirates are good role models in our current kind of time when we're facing existential crisis. And in order to have your own freedom as a pirate, you had to own your own boat. So the vast majority of sailors didn't own their own boat. And if you were a pirate, you owned the boat you sailed on. And so in today's world, if you're a techie, for example, you maybe want to own your own property. If you want to own your own company or house, then as a techie, you end up working in the corporate world where you maybe live in a major city and prices of real estate are very expensive, so you kind of have to have a high salary to pay for that. This is a farm in Italy that I recently looked at that's potentially available for free. This is a palace in India that I went to visit where there's not really a lot of interest in it. It's just kind of sitting there dormant, and the owner would really like some innovators to come and do some cool stuff there. And India is particularly interesting because it has a large number of young people that are sort of disaffected by the corporate world and looking for something more interesting to do. This is the chapel that I bought in Wales in 2010. And this is some images inside, how it's looking fairly recently. This is some work going on in progress. This is a upper deck, and basically building it out as a kind of residential accelerator space where people can live and work. And in this kind of remote location, the economic costs of supporting a team are more or less negligible. So I'd guess if say one techie was to work in a corporate job at full salary, they could probably afford to keep a team of say 10 living very nicely in a rural location with healthy food and optimized environment, flow states, and this kind of stuff. This is our kitchen. We have some volunteers helping. And that's the view from the main chapel window. So in the 1800s, you had to get your own ship, and today it certainly helps if you can get your own building, but it's really great if you can make your own money and make your own economic system that allows you to get your building. So this is what I'm working on, and really looking for ideas and support, and is broad invitation for open collaboration on how to design the token economics. I know that crypto token schemes seem to not be very popular around here, but they're definitely, I think they have a lot of merit. So if you take a building that some of them may be available for free, they generally need a lot of work, and you need a huge range of skills to turn a project into a world-changing innovation. But there are a lot of people who are quite disaffected by the current paradigm, would like to see our planet as one that we can sustainably live on as human beings in the future, and willing to commit and put time and effort into making it work. So I think crypto tokens gives the possibility of decentralizing the trust in terms of the reward for what happens when we have built a network of bases. Okay.
Three, two, one. Yeah.
Please move the clicker here. We need the thanks.
All right. Next up is let me check first. So did you show up? Last call? Open hardware and free software camera? No. Okay, then we'll go on with the last talk, which is in German, which is about lightning talks. I think I have to go over there.
Hallo, ich bin Svollis und ich habe eine Angewohnheit. Ich mache Lightning Talks.
einfach nur so zum Spaß, mittlerweile seit dem 30C3. Und letztes Jahr haben Getzig und ich uns so ein bisschen unterhalten über Sachen, die hier liefen. Und dann gab es so eine Situation, oh, dieser Talk hätte so schön können werden, wenn. Und dann haben wir uns überlegt, über dieses Wenn machen wir jetzt nochmal einen kleinen Lightning Talk.
Ja, da sage ich auch noch kurz was zu. Ich bin Getzig, danke für die Vorstellung. Ich habe mit den Lightning Talks im 30C3 angefangen. Damals hat Nick Farr das Staffelholz quasi übergeben. Da saßen wir in einem kleinen Team neben ihm auf der Bühne und aus diesem Team hat sich dann irgendwie dann doch dieses kleine Team mit Alex und mir entwickelt. Und damals wäre so eine Referenz für Einsteiger ganz nützlich gewesen. Inzwischen gibt es ja auch viele kleinere Chaos-Events in anderen Städten, die Lightning Talks machen. Und da gibt es einfach eine Menge zu lernen. Diese ganze Erfahrung will ich halt noch ein bisschen nach außen tragen. Dementsprechend mache ich mal kurz weiter. Im Prinzip organisiert man hier eine kleine Tagung. Wir haben jetzt hier im Kongress zum Beispiel 60 bis 70 Vortragende. Das ist ein Aufwand, den man nicht unterschätzen sollte. Denn man hat viel Mailverkehr mit den Leuten, die hier einen Talk halten wollen. Deswegen muss man sich schon Gedanken machen über seine Prozesse, dass man eine effiziente Abwicklung für die ganze Geschichte findet. Denn das ist nicht nur für die Orga wichtig, sondern auch für die Speaker, denn dann kann man sich vernünftiger um sie kümmern. Wichtig ist dabei, dass man irgendwie toolgestützt arbeitet. Wir haben das mal mit dem Wiki gemacht. Das lief ganz gut, aber es gibt so eine Grand Unification der Informationen zum Kongress mit Pre-Talks oder dem FRAP. Dann ist es auch wichtig, dass man die wesentlichen Regeln vorher erklärt, damit man eben nicht die ganzen Mails beantworten muss, die noch offene Fragen klären wollen. Und eigentlich ist ein wichtiger Punkt, sich die Arbeit aufzuteilen und ein bisschen entbehrlich zu werden. Single Point of Failure, habe ich gerade schon gesagt. Das ist bis jetzt noch nicht ganz so geglückt. Da bin ich für Vorschläge auch dankbar. Da könnt ihr euch beim Organisationsteam melden. Und das war es dann auch schon bezüglich der Organisation.
So, und ich will jetzt noch so ein bisschen aus dem, was ich so erlebt habe, erzählen. Wenn man so einen Lightning Talk macht, man möchte vielleicht ein Projekt vorstellen, ist halt die Frage, wer soll diesen Talk machen? Mein Vorschlag ist, wenn ihr einen Neuen dabei habt, der gerade so richtig enthusiastisch einsteigen will, nehmt den. Weil der hat Spaß an der Sache, der will das auch mit Spaß rüberbringen, so wie ich halt das auch mache. Ich mache das wirklich nur aus Spaß an den Lightning Talks. Wenn euer Englisch nicht das Beste ist, macht's auf Deutsch. Dieser ist jetzt auch das Beispiel, das ich zeigen möchte, dass es sinnvoll ist, einen Vortrag auf Deutsch zu machen und sich auf das wunderbare C3 Lingo Team zu verlassen. Und wenn ihr ein kleines Problem habt, so nach dem Motto, diese eine Folie kriege ich auf Englisch nicht vernünftig hin, dann kommt mal inoffiziell vorbei, fragt nach, sie helfen gerne. Die letzte Folie ist immer sinnvoll für Kontaktinformationen zu nutzen. Man sollte auch zusehen, dass sie halt einen Augenblick stehen bleibt, dass die Leute das wenigstens großartig grob erfassen können. Sehr praktisch ist auch so was wie Standort auf dem Kongress, wo die Woran zu finden ist, vielleicht ein QR-Code zum Einscannen, die anderen typischen Sachen, GitHub, was auch immer. Das Wichtigste ist den Vortrag üben, laut und mit Stoppuhr. Den Tipp, den ich auch gebe am Anfang, die Stoppuhr möglichst außerhalb des Sichtfeldes packen, wenn es ein Handy ist, einfach auf umdrehen, dass man es nicht sehen kann. Bei vielen Informationen auf das Wesentliche beschränken. Man kann ja halt auf den Folien ein bisschen mehr drauf haben. Und mit dem Üben mit der Stoppuhr langsam anfangen. Ich habe im zarten Alter von 39 Jahren mit Gitarrenunterricht angefangen. Und mein Gitarrenlehrer sagt mir immer, übe langsam, schneller wirst du von alleine, wenn du es kannst. Und das Gleiche gilt auch genauso für Lightning Talks. Wenn man wirklich mal Zeit hat, diesen Lightning Talk zu machen, ich bin meistens dann auch so, dass ich die ganzen Sachen ein bisschen mehr auf Kante mache, so vielleicht so über Weihnachten, dann wenn ich richtig gut drauf bin, vielleicht auch auf dem Kongress erst. Wenn man mit einem fertigen Talk zum Kongress kommt, hat man mehr Spaß vor Ort. Diesmal habe ich es wirklich wieder geschafft. Ich habe so im Hotel morgens noch so die letzten Kleinigkeiten gemacht und hier habe ich dann wirklich entspannt mich den anderen Sachen hingeben können, zum Beispiel im Poetry Slam, wo ich doch teilgenommen habe. Also es macht das Ganze angenehmer. Außerdem lohnt es sich, wenn man wirklich mal ein paar Lightning Talks aus dem letzten Jahr anzugucken. Mal zu gucken, was ist angekommen, was macht mir Spaß beim Gucken. Ich finde es zum Beispiel toll, wenn auf einmal aus diesen abstrakten Strichmännchen vielleicht Figuren aus South Park werden oder sonst irgendetwas. So die Kleinigkeiten. Angucken, was hat mir Spaß gemacht, was könnte ich vielleicht ähnlich machen. Ich will ja nicht South Park nehmen, ich will Peanuts nehmen. Sowas in der Richtung. Das lohnt sich. Also es ist wirklich, das macht das Ganze besser. Noch als Bitte von dem Orga-Team. Man braucht möglichst robuste universelle Dateiformate. PDF mit Fonts embedded, da gibt es halt eine Exportfunktion, ISO irgendwas, PDF 1-1A, wo da halt diese Font drin ist. Ich habe ja auch einen eigenen Font. und beim Export mit Keynote auf die Bildauflösung achten. Das hat man natürlich den Nachteil, wenn man hier steht, man hat halt nur seine eigenen Folien, wenn man halt so eine schöne Präsentationssoftware hat, hat man noch so eigene Notizen, die man halt haben kann. Oder man sieht die nächste Slide. Aber mit den eigenen Notizen, da gibt es einen richtig coolen alten Workaround, der nennt sich Notizzettel, habe ich hier auch. Und nochmal, üben. Wenn man jetzt hier Leute trifft und sie einfach sagen, ja, was machst du denn hier? Ja, ich mache morgen noch einen Lightning Talk. Und die dann nicht weglaufen, dann hat man ein Publikum, wo man üben kann. Nutzt es. Denn Practice makes perfect, das stimmt wirklich. Einfach üben hilft. Und man hat dann wirklich Spaß mit dem, was man halt hier tut. Und in diesem Sinne bedanke ich mich für eure Aufmerksamkeit. Und ich bedanke mich schon mal im Voraus für die Leute, die dann vielleicht jetzt auch dadurch sich ein bisschen inspiriert fühlen und die geilen Vorträge nächstes Jahr. Dieses Jahr habe ich nicht alles live gucken können. Ich werde mir aber alles angucken, weil wo ich live gesehen habe, waren ein paar Sachen dabei, die haben mich echt wieder umgehauen. Das war echt Spaß, das anzugucken. Und diese 5 Minuten pro Stück, gönnt euch mal. Vielen Dank.
So, thank you all for coming to all the speakers and the audience as well. Big round of applause for all the speakers who came up on stage here. And of course, for the wonderful translation team, especially the lightning talks are a difficult session to translate. So a big round of applause for them as well.